Well, good morning to you. Glad you're here. Welcome to all our campuses today. We're almost closing down our message series on what kind of church is this. We got one more weekend. And I know some of you are like, well, when are we going to be done? Next weekend, all right? Hang on there and we'll finish it up. But I've been thinking too, there's so much more to what kind of church are we than we're going to be able to cover. So I'm already thinking part two sometime here, maybe next year or something, but really glad. I cannot tell you how excited I am for the next series. The next series is called This Is For Everyone, and we are bringing in some of the greatest communicators in the nation to come and preach here for several weeks. And in 2 weeks, Gene Apple will be here, and you're like, Gene who? Gene Apple. You don't probably know him, but he is a pastor in Anaheim, California, and he's the president of the North American Christian Convention, and he will be speaking here in 2 weeks, and kicking off our message series called This Is For Everyone. And he's one of the greatest communicators in our nation. We are super thrilled to be able to have him here, and we'll get it kicked off in 2 weeks. So it'd be a great weekend to invite your family and friends to come. Gene's a good friend, and super excited that he'll be here. Okay, so what these qualities that we've been taking a look at for the last several weeks are super important. And what we're talking about today is something that I think that every church should have in their DNA. Every church, I would think, would want this in their DNA, but my experience is that very few churches have this as part of who they are. Jesus told us to go into all the world and to preach the gospel, and he's our master and commander, and our response is clear. You bet I will. I will. You are my master. We're not questioning him. We're obeying, and we're going, but far too many of us play it safe. We do. We play it safe. I think the kind of church we are, we want to be a risk-taking group of people. I do. I want to be a risk taker just in my own life. And being a risk taker is defined as a person who is willing to do things that involve danger or risk in order to achieve a goal. It's my contention is that it's almost impossible to grow in our relationship with God without being a risk taker. If a church is not willing to take a risk, we're never going to be able to live out our full potential for God. God has called us to be his body here on earth, and the challenge is tremendous, and the rewards are eternal. So why do so many of us, and why do so many churches play it safe? Number one, we hate change. We hate change. We're not big fans of change. We don't like it. We just sure like it'd be the same way, and many churches would rather die than change. I'm not suggesting that we change the message. And we talked about this a few weeks ago, right? We're a Bible-believing church. The message doesn't change, ever. We are solid on the Word of God, and that Jesus Christ is God's Son. That's never going to change. But there's a lot of things that do change over the course of years with the church. And if it doesn't, we're going to be in trouble. We've already seen that life is one constant change. Life is that way, and change is hard. No doubt about it, and we're going to have to figure out whether or not we want to do hard things or not. A phrase that you oftentimes hear in a church that's afraid of change is, well, we've always done it that way. You ever been a part of a church that said that? It was kind of like that. After we say it that just kind of shuts down the conversation. Well, we've always done it that way. Oh, okay, I guess that since it was written in the King James Bible, we're going to do it that way. I mean, we just don't have any options. Once somebody says, we've always done it that way, it shuts things down. It just usually says, I don't care what you say, we're not going to do it. Another reason we don't like to take risk is we're scared. It's kind of a big one. It's the what happens if thing, you know, that, well, you know, and we worry about the worst case scenarios. What if it looks like if it doesn't work out? What if we're going to look stupid? What if nobody shows up? What if nobody cares? That's why we don't ask our friends to church. What if they say no? What if they don't like it? So many of us never take any kind of risk because we're afraid. This is why so many of us have never taken a risk for Jesus. I'd like to go on one of those mission trips, but I'm a little scared. I'd like to volunteer in the church children's ministry, but I'm a little scared. I'd like to help out in the middle school ministry, but I'm super scared of that. And that's a real fear, by the way. I'm not making that up. Right, Al? That's a huge fear. I'd like to get baptized, but I'm scared. I'd like to try out for the worship team, but I'm a little scared. Just so you know, faith is never meant to be safe. It's not. Following Jesus is not a safe thing to do. Eventually, you are going to be asked by Jesus himself to take some sort of risk. It might be scary, but you're going to have to decide whether or not you're going to do it or not. Another reason we don't like to be risk takers is we have trust issues. Faith is a trust thing. It always has been, always will be. You have to decide if you can trust somebody before you're going to be willing to take a step of faith. I've told you this, when I fly, I always wanted to be a pilot. I thought that would be a great career and a great job, and I always wanted to be one until I flew. My stomach just doesn't handle it very well, and I don't like flying. I really don't like flying now because of all the hassles that go along with flying and getting there, but in order to get to some places that I want to go, flying is essential. I want to get there, and so I have to fly, and so I go through a checklist every time I do this, and one of the things that really bothers me about flying is they call it a terminal, right? When you use that word terminal, what does that usually mean? Oh, that's really bad. Oh, they're terminal. Oh. So we go to a terminal. And then we have to go through the security stuff and go through the thing. And by the way, if you think security is bad here, like they're invasive here, go to India. It is awkward, to say the least. And they're mean, and they don't like people. And it's like, oh, my goodness. And you just know, oh, no. Especially for our gals that went on the trip. They're like, they put you in a room, they shut the curtain. You're like, what's going on in there? You don't want to know. Okay. And then you're just like, all right. But you have to figure out, will these people that pay attention keep the bad people out of there? And then you go down and as you get to the end of the thing and you step onto the plane, you think, I wonder, you always have to think this, I wonder if the pilots are sober. Yeah. Right? You have to think that, especially if you have an afternoon flight. You know, what have they been doing for a while? I think that I saw them in the lounge. Oh, great. And are the mechanics, did they pay attention when they brought the plane in and did some service stuff? Is the air traffic control guys competent? And that's a real concern for me. My son Mitch grew up with a kid named Mike right down the street, and they're best friends, and they did a lot of stuff together. And Mike is an air traffic controller now, and he was an idiot, right? How did he get through school? I don't know. I'm thinking, well, if that's the best we've got, all right. You have to think through all of that stuff. And in the moment you step on the plane, you have done what? You have taken a step of faith. And you can't do anything about any of that stuff. There's nothing you can do. It's out of your control. And if you can't trust the air traffic controller, and if you can't trust the mechanic, and if you can't trust the pilot, and if you can't trust the security people, you don't get on the plane, right? You talk yourself out of it. I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. And truly, I step on that plane every time and think, well, all right. And that's what it is. And when we have trust issues, you have to decide, can I trust? James chapter 2, verse 17 says, so you see, faith by itself isn't enough. What? Faith by itself isn't enough unless it produces good deeds. It is dead and useless. Now, someone may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I'll show you my faith by my good deeds. You say you have faith, you believe in there is one God, good for you. Good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. How foolish. Can't you see that faith without good deeds is useless? Don't you remember that our ancestor Abraham was shown to be right with God by his actions? When he offered his son Isaac on the altar, you see his faith and his actions work together. His actions made his faith complete. Anybody can believe in God. Our nation is a very religious group of people. We, not a lot of atheists. We may disagree on the gods we're worshiping, but we're believing in something, a higher power, a great God in the sky kind of person. But what we do know is, like, anybody can have faith. It's not a big deal to say that you believe in God. Even the demons believe that. If you were to ask one, I wouldn't do that, I guess. I wouldn't encourage you to, if you see one, to say, hey, do you want to go to church? Or no. But basically what he's saying is that even the demons, even Satan believes, right? It's no big deal. They don't have faith, though. James recalls the story of Abraham, the father of faith, and his son Isaac. For the Jew, Abraham was the man of faith. No one would argue that this man had faith. He was the father of faith. And God told him to offer up his son Isaac as a sacrifice. It seemed confusing. Abraham and Sarah had prayed for a child. They had hoped for a child, but they were not able to conceive. They were heartbroken. Eventually, this is kind of how it's going to be in our life. We're not going to have a child. God told them they would have a child, and they kind of laughed it off, like, no, you got to be kidding. My wife's super old. There's no way possible. We're not even, like, thank you very much, but no. But she gets pregnant. They have a boy, Isaac, the promised one by God. It seemed impossible. The miracle takes place, and every day they saw this little baby, and they would hold this little baby. You know what they thought? God is good. God's faithful. He promised this. Every single day was a reminder of how good God was and that he could be trusted. Then God tells him to do the unthinkable, to offer his son as a sacrifice. Seemed totally out of character for God to do this, by the way. Totally out of character. This God, right, he does not demand human sacrifice. Other gods, do in their culture did. There was offering of human sacrifice, of child sacrifices, and it was horrid and detestable to God. But here he is now asking Abraham to take his promised child, his only son, to sacrifice to God. The crazy thing is that Abraham doesn't lose faith, and he goes forward with it. He takes his boy and takes his knife, gathers some wood. They go to the area of sacrifice and ties his son up. I'm guessing everybody's crying at this moment. Abraham has got to be crying. Isaac is crying. Nobody likes this. He raises his hand to kill his child, and God stops him. Provides a different alternative. Another sacrifice is available. Isaac lives. And again, once again, God could be trusted. Without faith, no one crosses the Red Sea. Without faith, nobody gets out of a boat and walks on water. Without faith, nobody catches a boatload of fish. Now, why does this matter? Well, here it tells us that without faith, it is impossible to please God. Christ followers, church, risk-taking is in our business. And if the church doesn't take risk, it slowly dies. Faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. A church without taking a step will eventually die. 3,000 churches will close their doors this year. Thousands or more in a holding pattern. Half the churches in America did not add one member to their roster by conversion this past year. If the church isn't going to change, it will go away. And I'm glad I'm a part of a church that lives by faith. Our church has been living by faith and struggling to figure that out for a long time now. And 10 years ago, our church had reached a boiling point where we had filled up our little building on Fort Street. And it wasn't that little building, but we were able to get about 500-600 people in there. We had 3 services, and we were pretty excited about the number of people we were seeing come to the Lord. We bought 17 and a half acres out here on 156th Street. There was not much here at the time. And so it took us a couple years before we could build, and on the first year we were here, we averaged 755 people. It was a huge risk. We raised $1.5 million, and we borrowed the rest so we could get onto this campus. It was a huge risk for a little church. We didn't have any debt at the time. We were fine. Everything was good. But we were compelled by a mission that told us to walk by faith. And now 10 years later, we average over 2,000 people on a weekend. We've added more to our buildings and a 10,000 square foot building in Millard. And now we have a campus in Fremont and a church in Ecuador. And hundreds of people are baptized every year. What if we had decided not to walk by faith? Who would not be able to go to heaven now? Because we said we've always done it that way. Or what if something bad happens? I'm a little scared. What if we stop now? What if we decide to stop now? Now, I don't know what is next. Sometimes people go, what do you think is next? Well, I really don't know what the next step is. I think it will involve a big step of faith. John Acuff recently wrote, taking a leap of faith isn't an excuse to make a dumb choice. You can be brave and smart at the same time. Jesus teaches us all the time to count the cost. Luke chapter 14, 28 says, but don't begin until you count the cost. For who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there's enough money to finish it? But once the counting has been done, oftentimes we talk ourselves out of it. I would like to, but I don't think so. It's not a matter of cost. It becomes a matter of faith at that moment. So let me ask you, what steps of faith are you going to take this year? What has caused you to pause just for a moment and pray? What has caused you for just a second to count the cost? Risk-taking always involves a little bit of that. If it doesn't cost you much, it probably isn't much of a faith. If it doesn't cost you much, it really isn't faith, is it? Luke 17, verse 5 says, the apostles said to the Lord, show us how to increase our faith. What a great statement, right? Show us how to increase our faith. Now, I'll get back to that, but he keeps going in verse 6. The Lord answered, if you have faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to the mulberry tree, may you be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. For it's not the size of your faith that matters. It really isn't. A mustard seed's insignificant. It's not a big-time player. Most seeds are not really big. They're just really little. And he says, if you have faith like the size of this, you can do amazing things. How many times have we said, as a church, that's impossible? How many times have we said that as just individuals? Well, I can't do that. I don't have much time. I don't have much knowledge. I really don't have much faith. You don't have to have much faith. It doesn't take very much. By ourselves, there's a lot of things that are impossible, but with God, all things are. So it's really not too much about my faith, but it is important who my faith is in. So would you ever muster up enough courage to ask God to increase your faith? And that's a scary thing, right? It's like, God, please increase my faith. In fact, we would rather pray for patience than that. Grant me patience. Now, by the way, you don't even have to pray for that. Because if you aren't patient, he will provide opportunities for you to figure that out. He will. He will provide opportunities. That's just called growth. You don't have to pray for patience. He will give you plenty of chances to figure it out. But faith. So if you could, what would you do? Some of you are finally going to invite somebody to go to church with you this year. You're going to muster up enough courage to ask them, and it doesn't really matter if they don't show up or not. You are just supposed to take the risk. And if they do, even better. If they do, even better. It's all right. Some of you are finally going to start serving at StoneBridge. You're going to have the courage enough to volunteer, to say yes when somebody asks you to do something. You want to grow in your faith. You're just like, well, please increase my faith. And you'll see a little blurb that comes up. It's like, please go with us to Mexico. Please go with us to Ecuador. Please go with us to India. And you're going to get a little bit of that going, man, I think I'm supposed to do that. You want to grow in your faith? Go on a mission trip. If you want to grow in your faith, give some money. I thought about that. You know, think about how ridiculous it is that we give money. We give it away. Money that we've worked for and earned and, you know, have, and then we just give it. We don't get a whole lot to the deal. We're not buying anything. We don't get a shirt, nothing like that. Unless you get baptized, you get a shirt, which is kind of nice, and you get a free shirt. But that's a huge risk to start giving away our hard-earned money. But it's a step of faith. Maybe it would be a step of faith for you to give towards our Millard campus. Take some risks this year. So if there's one thing that you could do for God and you knew that you wouldn't fail, what would you do? What would you want to do? There's one thing that would cause you to pause for just one second. Maybe it is just to start giving, and you're just like, I don't know how this is going to work out. Where is this going to come from? How am I going to get it? Maybe it's going to say, you know what? I'm finally going to go to a Bible study. I want to increase my faith, and I really don't know how to do this. I'm going to find my way there. For the first time, I'm going to talk to my mom and dad about coming to church with me. It hasn't gone so well in the past, but I'm sure enough and a little bit of faith to do that. I mean, what little step this year could you take that would cause you to pause for just a second and go, I'm a little scared. I don't know if I can do this. What if I fail? Right? And then you have to ask yourself, am I willing to trust God? Now, I love being a part of a church that takes risks. I think I would have left a long time ago. It's just kind of in my DNA to do that. I think I got it from my dad a little bit. He's like a huge risk taker, always thinking of dumb things for us to do as a church or as a family, and you know, as risk taking things and way out there, stuff that nobody else is doing. And I just watched him navigate through those worlds and still does. My dad, at 80 plus years of age, still dreams, dumb dreams. I think, what are you doing? For his little church in Brownville, Nebraska, he just has these, it's like, what if we go to two services? And I think, two services? Way to go! Way to go, Dad! You're just still dreaming of those dumb dreams that you think, what will happen? And I don't know if he'll ever get it done, but maybe so. I have lots of dreams for this church. I do. Still do. In fact, I'm pretty sure that the next 10 years are going to be a whole lot better than the last 10. I can't wait to see what things are going to be done in this city and throughout the state of Nebraska as we continue to fulfill the mission that God has called us to. Thank you so much for being a part of it. Let's pray. You are the God of this city, there's no doubt about it. Or at least you want to be. When you look at our city, we do see a lot of stuff that's going on that we want to be part of the solution. We don't want anybody in Omaha, in Millard, Fremont, the next places we go to hell. We don't want anybody to go to hell in Ecuador or Romania or Mexico or India. We look for the next step of faith as we take as a church. I look back over the last couple of years and I think, what in the world is going on here? And how did we get all this stuff done? And yet, there's still more to be done in this city. So we look forward to the challenges that are before us. May we be people of faith. In Christ we pray.